Good morning. Welcome to the seventh meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed. We now turn to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on the committee's pre-budget work in preparation of the Scottish Government's publication of its 22-23 budget. I'm pleased to see that we have our panel of witnesses, our first panel of witnesses online today. The focus of the first panel is to take a broader look at the budget and to further explore child poverty targets. The focus of the second panel is the Scottish Fiscal Commission's forecast social security spend, particularly their forecast for the adult disability payment. I welcome to the meeting our first panel, who are joining us remotely, Ailey Dixon, Policy and Parliamentary Manager for Engender, Satwat Rayman, Director, One Parent Families Scotland, John Sparks, the Chief Executive of Crisis, and Laurie Morgan-Klein, Public Affairs Officer from Step Change. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. A few housekeeping points to mention before we kick off. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn on your microphones before you start to speak. Witnesses can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in on a question, but don't feel you have to answer every single question if you have nothing new to add to what's already been said by others. That's okay too. We have around an hour for this session, and as I've intimated to colleagues in the committee, if you could direct your questions to whichever witness you would prefer answering them, or all, if that, whichever the case may be. So I would like to begin by asking Pam Duncan-Glancy to ask a first set of questions, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thanks very much for joining us and also for the submissions you've sent in. They've been very, very helpful. This week, as you'll know, the Joseph Rowntree reported on poverty at the beginning of the week in Challenge Poverty Week, and they highlighted the importance of lifting people in the 6 target groups in Scotland out of poverty. So I wondered if the panel could say something about what would be needed in terms of employment support to do this for lone parents, for women and for disabled people, and also what role you think Social Security has within that context. Thank you.
So, as it's directed to all panellists, could I start with Ailey Dixon, please, followed by John, Satwat and Laurie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and to the rest of the committee for inviting Engender today. Directly on Pam Duncan-Glancy's question around labour market support for women, I think it's vital, firstly, to point out that women exist in every single priority group, and we need to take an intersectional approach to the labour market support that we are putting in place to support each group. Close the Gap are obviously Scotland's gender and labour market experts, and I highly recommend that the committee look at some of their work that they have done, which demonstrates that women, particularly younger women, and therefore most likely to correlate with the age group who have children, and Black and minority ethnic women who are likely to have larger families, or statistically larger to have larger families, are likely to work in the sectors who have been most affected by pandemic-related restrictions. Whilst furlough has been a useful tool in supporting or at least suppressing some of the higher rates of employment we might have otherwise expected to see because of the disruption that those sectors have experienced, obviously furlough is now coming to an end, and we are still, I think, waiting to see what the future holds in relation to labour market disruption. But women have also experienced labour market disruption because of the distribution of care that has been removed from the state back into the household over the pandemic, for care for children and care for older people and for disabled people. And so we need to take a kind of whole system look at this problem, and Social Security will play a vital role in that. Women are more likely to work part-time and therefore likely to use Social Security to top up their income, both through kind of universal credit, but also other payments around supporting families, including the Scottish Child Payment and Best Start grants. And so I think there's a really important role for Social Security to play. I think we need to support some of the industries, that some of the sectors that women's employment are working in through budget-related measures. And I think it's really important at this stage to make the point clearly that we will not reach the child poverty targets unless we support women's labour market access and Social Security access to incomes. We need to bear in mind that children do not kind of care for themselves, and we need to pay attention to the fact that mothers still do the vast majority of unpaid care for children, and play that kind of take on that mental load as well of support for children. I will leave it there, but I might come back on more specific points that we can look to. I'll leave it to others who work more closely with the labour market maybe to come in before I say any more.
Thank you, Ailey. John.
I support everything Ailey has just said about disproportionate impact, and certainly from a homelessness point of view, while the single biggest reason we see women becoming homeless relates to domestic abuse, it's too easy to assume that's everything, whereas actually the underlying causes relate to poverty and relate to in the workplace, in family, and so on. I would just highlight a couple of points. One is the knock-on impact on children and why this particular line of questions is so important. Last year, there were 11,800 children in families who were assessed as homeless, which of course is devastating at that particular time for those children, but the impact is very, very long-term. All of the research shows us the two biggest predictors, not necessarily causes, but predictors of homelessness as an adult, are poverty as a child and adverse childhood experiences. And such adverse childhood experiences may actually include being homeless. So you can see there's an intergenerational cycle here. That's why it's so important to tackle. The thing I would just stress around tackling that is the impact of housing costs. And what we've seen in Scotland in particular and particularly in the private rented sector, very high increases in the housing cost to income ratio for working age households over the last couple of decades in Scotland. And clearly that's a driver of poverty that needs to be addressed. And I would point to a couple of things. One is the evidence that One Parent Family Scotland gave, which about increasing the DHP budget and directing local authorities to target additional funds towards people affected by benefit cap, and therefore mitigating some of the impact of that cap, as being one way of closing that that ratio between housing costs and an ability. Hey, the other piece I would point to is the Chartered Institute of Housing saying that Scottish Government should consider making use of its social security powers to top up support for housing costs in the PRS, in the private rented sector, as a direct way of addressing this. I'll stop there. There may be some more specific points to come back on, but I'll stop at that point.
Thank you, John. Satwat.
Thank you very much, everyone, and hello. I think I'm just thinking about the current situation we're in terms of what we're trying to do around child poverty. We're actually in a situation for many of the families we're working with, they're seeing a loss of income with the £20 cut that we saw to UC. We're seeing increasing household costs and concerns about further increases in household costs. Fuel is a big issue. So we're actually in a situation where things could potentially get a lot worse before we begin to look to see how we can support to get better. So I think in the short term, social security plays a critical role in this, and the work that we've done with partners who are here giving evidence and others around the need to double the Scottish child payment, etc. We need to support families that we're working with to be able to stabilise income before we can start to look at the employment and the training and the qualification support for the longer term. Because I mean, you know, some of what John said, I mean, all these things are fundamental: housing, adequate income, etc. And what many of the parents we work with have told us is that actually the impact of COVID-19 and the measures that we had to take to restrict the spread of COVID-19 have created a situation of them where they've been at home alone, homeschooling, trying to look for work, trying to work, etc. And the impact on health and well-being, what many of them have said is don't expect us to be able to pick up from where we left off at the start of this. We feel we need further support, we can do that. And I think when we're looking at employment and training initiatives, we need to be building that in. We need to be looking at it in a holistic way. So we've got family support, health and wellbeing support, et cetera, all part and parcel of what we see as employment support for the families that we're working with. But in terms of the specifics, we were very, very pleased to see an increase in Parent Employability Support Fund, and within that, looking at a specific bespoke offer for single parent families. I think if we're going to be able to tackle child poverty effectively in the short and medium term, whilst we need those sorts of general overall employability initiatives, we need to begin to drill down into what are the specifics for each of those priority groups and how do we support them and address some of those specifics. And going back to Ailey's points around intersectionality and intersecting inequalities, many of the families in poverty cut across more than one of those priority groups. So we need to look to see how we can come up with a programme which recognises the specifics of the experience. And I think what's also critical around employment is ensuring that the support is integrated and aligned with childcare, with transport links, with all those things that we need to make sure are in place in order to make the transition to work for those who can work and want to work something that's going to be relatively easy, as opposed to a series of hurdles that they need to overcome. And I think critical to that is training and qualifications and how we support families within the priority groups and families living in poverty on a journey towards a good job, not just any job, because the work first approach we have at the moment in terms of the punitive benefit system that we have is very much any job. But we want jobs that are going to support single parents to balance their responsibilities as the sole carer, as well as being the sole breadwinner, and not want to be at the expense of the other. And we would really like to see something like the equivalent of the Young Parent Guarantee for those families in the priority groups and those families living in poverty, and a sort of pathway being developed which aligns where we know we're going to have growth in good quality jobs in the future to support those families, those parents living in poverty, to be in a position to be able to take up some of those jobs. So we're not just looking at the traditional sectors that women have gone into, but where are some of the growth, you know, as part of the just transition, green jobs, etc., and how can we make this integral and part and parcel of that journey? I'll stop there.
Thank you, Satwa. That's very helpful. Laurie.
Laurie, convener, I think I've lost you.
We can hear you. Your video feed is struggling a little bit, but we can hear you.
All right. Okay, well, that's good. You're spared the sight of my face. thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today and hello. I think that this is a really sort of crucial question from a problem debt perspective. We know that often when we're talking about problem debt, we're talking about women. The majority of the people that we advise are women, over 60% of our clients, and that's a very sort of steady percentage. There's many reasons behind that. Drilling down specifically into priority families and households with children, so far in 2021, 39% of our clients come from households with children, and we know there's a particular pressure on lone parents. And I'm particularly concerned about the impact, you know, particularly on age group, because we've seen a big shift in the age of our clients through last year and into this year. Now, this was a long-running trend, moving from a kind of older, late middle-aged group to a younger people in their mid-20s to through to their 30s. And this is really apparent in the past year as well. So there's a shifting burden onto the younger lone parents at the moment too. and the wider vulnerability impact as well can't be understated either. The significant mental health challenges that our clients are facing are increasing. We have more clients that are vulnerable. One of the issues it's kind of the crux of many problems here is linked to what was being said earlier around housing costs, priority of years, council tax, utility costs, rent. All of these things are pressing really heavily, and they're often the most challenging area of debt that we have to advise people on. I think it's also really important to say at this point that the majority of people who are coming to us for help are renters, and many of those with private landlords. So there's a real concern there on how tenants are able to deal with these priority costs, and then particularly that pressure is really increases for our clients with children who are in these vulnerable groups. And I mean, one way we can look at that is the tenant support grant has recently been announced, and the tenant hardship loan fund for that matter. We actually need to widen the conversation around that, because it's great that the grant takes on rent arrears, but clients we advise, it's not just rent. If someone is behind on rent, they are likely behind on utility bills, council tax as well, and we have to see all of that together. And I think if we could look at the grant and see how we could address some of these priority costs as well, because what will be happening is that clients will be utilising what credits available to them to pay these priority bills, because they recognise the importance of these bills to their safety and to their security and of their families for those clients with children. So I think we need to look really carefully at what more we can do there. I think also I think the longevity of support is really crucial. But, you know, furlough's been mentioned as being really good for sustaining employment, and it has been. Obviously, that's coming to an end. Universal credit, which hopefully we can talk a bit more about later on, that is having a huge impact, the cut here. And that's particularly going to have an impact on vulnerable clients of ours who make up the priority group. So, longevity of the support is crucial, and my hope would be that we can maintain the tenant support grant beyond March 2022. We need to look at putting more funding into that, because one of the crucial things, and I really want to land around problem debt, is that it is a long-term impact on finances. Clients who have maybe just kept their heads above water over the past 18 months have lost their financial resilience and will be vulnerable to further financial shocks, just the ordinary life events that we all sometimes experience will continue to leave households vulnerable for a number of years now. So I think we've got to really make sure that we don't just see this as the public health consequences here are receding, we hope, and the therefore we can begin to look at moving away from supporting households that have been impacted by COVID. But those households, we will have clients coming to us for help in years to come now, who have directly will be able to trace their issues with debt right back to what's happened over the past year. So there's a particular pressure on lone parents, which we are really concerned about, and also wider families with children. We know that there's a particular vulnerability there, and that's definitely something we can see in our statistics.
Thank you very much indeed, Laurie. Ailey, I think you were wanting to come back in briefly there.
I did. Thank you very much. Just to make a very quick point in relation to some of the things that Satwa in particular was talking about there around childcare and support for labour market access for women, is I think we need to make sure that we're aligning and there is coherence between things like the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan and employability support and programmes like Living Wage. 60% of workers paid less than the living wage are women, which obviously has a huge impact on ability to meet the child poverty delivery targets. So I think there are policy frameworks in place that we just need to make sure are well aligned when we're having some of the discussions about what more is needed. And just also to fully agree with the point about the immediacy of social security as a lever, not being the only lever, but being one that we need to look at with perhaps some urgency as we wait to see some of the payoffs in things like the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan.
Thank you very much indeed, Ailey. Marie.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just to direct my first question to one-parent families. Despite our best efforts, the UK government are going ahead with the biggest ever overnight cut to Social Security since the 1930s by cutting the £20 uplift to UC. How big a blow do you think that is to everyone's effort to reduce child poverty?
Well, it's a significant blow to reduce child poverty. It's one of the things I just said in my introduction was that it's one of those things which is going to make it harder for us in the short term to look to see what we can do. I just want to let you know, I've got a quote here from a parent which I think says it better than I do. How will I manage once the additional £20 benefit money stops? I have a child off school self-isolating. I've had a benefit check and I'm getting what I'm entitled to, but I don't have enough money to live on. I'm feeling overwhelmed with worry about it all, the cost of Christmas looming. I feel a failure as I cannot afford to buy Christmas presents. This is somebody thinking about that now in September, do you know? And that's the story that we've been hearing through our local services from parents, is that there is a big worry and a concern about what is going to be the impact of this and the number of families that are going to be impacted and this disproportionate impact on single parent families that we see. We also have other things, and I do want to just briefly mention that we've been running a campaign to stop the young parent penalty. Because if you're a young parent on UC, you get less. Because it's about age, the age back, you know. And so there's a whole series of disadvantages and disconnects built into the system that we've currently got. But in terms of, yes, it is going to make things more difficult. But I mean, we have a national mission here in Scotland that we've all signed up to end child poverty. So I think it's about looking to see what we've got and how we can use what we've got to support families who are going to be affected by this, but also just not having had enough income to live on over time. And that's why I'd said that in the short term, we need to look to see what we can do with social security here in Scotland. And that's why the Scottish Child Payment is so critical. Some of the other benefits we've got here in Scotland are absolutely critical. And I think what we need to do is to ensure that we're supporting families living in poverty to access all that they're entitled to. So I know one of the things that was in the budget papers was around advice and information services, and I think they're going to be critical as we go forward to support families to be able to get what they're entitled to as the starting point, and then look to see how we can build on that through supporting the parents that we're working with into good quality work. But no, it is going to have a significant impact. Yeah.
Thank you.
Laurie and John, you wanted to come in at that point as well?
Yes, just briefly, but to reinforce a comment that Laurie made about longevity. And that's two things. First of all, this isn't just about the pandemic. So we were already over a couple of decades seeing significant increases in the number, proportion of renters in Scotland who simply had a shortfall between their housing benefit and their rent. You know, that was already a growing situation. And now, of course, over the last 18 months, we've seen record numbers of people falling into rent arrears as well, and therefore teetering on the brink of homelessness. And just to use some research from our colleagues at Shelter Scotland, they have estimated that the cost of somebody being evicted to the public purse is £15,000. So I think that reinforces the financial need to step in, rather, as well as the very obvious human need. But I think all I would say is that there will be a theme running across everything everybody says, that there has been significant support put in place by the Scottish Government, but longevity is the issue. We can't imagine for a second that the pandemic is that even the ending of the public health element of the pandemic is the end. The economic emergency, the people that we're talking about, people on the lowest incomes, will last for years, and that support needs to go with them.
Many thanks, John. Briefly, Laurie, and then Ailey.
Thank you. Just to add on universal credit, it's a frankly calamitous impact that we're going to see. We know that the average deficit budget for our clients in Scotland goes from -£33 to -£119. We know that our clients on universal credit who are in a positive budget before, as in they had surplus left where they could had some room to manoeuvre, goes from 56% of our clients to 31%, and the negative figure for that, while previously 44% of universal credit clients had a negative budget, that jumps to 69%. And that might sound a bit dry in the figures, but what that means is a complete cutting off of options for these households. It ultimately will mean that insolvency is they're going to be their main option for resolving debt. So I think we can't underestimate the huge impact that this is having.
And briefly, Ailey.
Thank you. I won't restate everything that everyone has already said, although obviously I agree that the impact for women of the cut is calamitous, to borrow a word. But women are also more likely to rely on public services, which have been affected by a kind of decade of cuts. 86% of the net cuts in the decade of austerity came out of women's budgets, and that was before the pandemic. So women are already facing a squeeze on income, coupled with kind of rising consumer costs. And there are actions in Scotland that we need to be prioritising. So there's been this commitment to the split of the universal credit payment to reduce the impact of the household payment, which denies women access to an independent income. Action on that has been slowed, not the fault of the Scottish Government, because of the pandemic, but we really need to see action on that progressing quite rapidly, as well as how we can better target things like the Scottish Child Payment to support primary caregivers, and addressing some of the chronically low benefits that carers, the chronically low value of benefits that carers receive. So yeah, I wanted to add that to the point about the cut.
Many thanks, that's helpful. Briefly, with a supplementary, Marie McNair, please.
It was actually, I wanted to pose another question, so it was to crises. I'm going to direct my question. I note your comments regarding the housing costs and evidence from the Joseph Rowntree. At one of our previous meetings shared the same view that single parents face very high housing costs. How much is praising the local housing allowance rates contributed to this?
It's certainly a part of it. I mean, just to step back and look at homelessness more broadly, I think there is clearly strong progress in Scotland on homelessness. If we compare across the UK, the proportion of households in Scotland experiencing the worst forms of homelessness is significantly lower than in either England or Wales, and that's based on policy decisions that have been taken in Scotland. That said, it's certainly by no means complete. We're still looking at, partly because of the pandemic, but partly because of trends that were already in place before the pandemic, record levels of households in temporary accommodation. And we're also looking at a level of about 15% of people who are experiencing homelessness have already experienced homelessness previously in the last 5 years. So we clearly haven't broken that cycle of poverty for those people. But what is going to be important, there are three things about addressing homelessness in Scotland which are working and need to be backed and need the longevity of funding. One is the move of local authorities to a an approach known simply as rapid rehousing. So transitioning away from a default being a temporary accommodation option to the default being a permanent settled housing option. And that's being backed by the Scottish Government, but needs to continue to be backed, because in some ways the pandemic has thrown that slightly off course. The second is the area of Housing First, which again is a success. The Housing First programme so far has housed over 500 people with the most complex sets of support needs, and their tenancy sustainment is between 85 and 90% across that programme, but that needs to continue, and again the theme of longevity needs to be there. And the third area is around prevention. Part of prevention, of course, is everything we've been talking about income, because primarily homelessness is an issue of poverty, is an issue of not being able to afford a place to live. So all of the mechanisms that we've talked about need to be backed, because refreezing the local housing allowance will continue to have a worsening impact, of course, as prices go up. To give one indication of the opposite, when local housing allowance last April or May, I think, was moved back to that 30th percentile of local markets level that it used to be in 2012, our team in Edinburgh did a count of properties, homes that would be available to our clients who were experiencing homelessness at LHA levels. And the figure went up from an average of about 20 or 30 at any one time prior to that change to more than 400 after that change. So clearly we can see that LHA at the 30th percentile has a significant impact on being able to tackle homelessness. The final thing I'd say on homelessness is there has been a lot of really good work done on the area of tenancy sustainment and preventing homelessness. But I'm very, very pleased to see the Scottish Government will be consulting on far-reaching homelessness prevention duties coming in the future, where the proposals will include starting to address and prevent homelessness 6 months before it happens, rather than when it actually becomes an emergency, making sure that other public services are also involved where it's clear that that people are at significant risk of homelessness, so prisons, social services, the health sector, making sure there are effectively ask and act duties on those bodies. But I think that emphasis on prevention will need to continue, and there is a financial element to that. You know, we can do all we like on debt advice and so on, but we also need to make sure the debt doesn't happen by supporting the income of those families.
Thank you very much indeed, John. Conscious as I am of time, I have a very brief question for Satwat and Ailey, sticking to the theme of employability and child poverty targets. How much of an impact, starting with you, Satwat, do you reckon extending universal free childcare to one and most one-year-olds and two-year-olds will have on both employability and on the child poverty targets?
Okay. I think it's going to have a significant impact on employability, because it's going to provide a space for the parents that we work with and others within the priority groups to be able to look at qualifications. And I think that's critical here, because one of the things that we really need to develop is a sort of skills and qualifications pathway for the families that we work with. And so it's going to provide opportunities for parents to be able to engage in learning earlier if they choose to, because they will be comfortable and confident that their child is somewhere safe and secure and that they don't have to pay for it. I mean, the costs of under-freeze childcare is one of the biggest costs that the families that we work with have. So actually extending it down is something that we welcome, and we've welcomed alongside the already 1140 hours for 3 and 4 year olds and the commitment to look at out of school childcare, wraparound childcare as well, what that there was. Because I think we need to look at childcare in the whole, because we need to start from it from the family's perspective, and you may have children across those age ranges. And so we need to make sure that what we have is a childcare service in Scotland that's able to meet the needs of families coherently to support families to be able to engage in learning and to be able to work. So it will have an impact on employability. It again will have an impact, I think, on costs. And I want to go again to something a parent said. There were two things, and I just thought they were really, really interesting. One of them said, childcare costs are crippling. I earn what I always considered to be a reasonable salary, but it costs more than I earn to send my two children to nursery for only 3 days a week. That's where it's going to make the significant difference. But I'm too scared to leave my job, as I don't want to lose the skills I have to try and break back into the job market. So actually, it will support women with progression in the labour market as well, if we have a coherent, comprehensive childcare offer. And going down to younger children from 1+, we think is a critical part of that.
Many thanks, Satwa. Briefly, in addition to that, Ailey, please.
Thank you. I agree, Satwa. Extending free and affordable childcare will make a huge difference to women's ability to undertake paid work. I think Engender has called for the scale of childcare provision in Scotland to be rapidly enhanced to 50 hours of fully flexible, affordable childcare per child per week. That recognises the fact that the current childcare provision does not necessarily have the flexibility that is needed in order to actually reflect how women engage with the labour market. The pause to the 11:40 hours, whilst for understandable reasons, and has meant that there are questions about the sustainability of many providers that need to be addressed if we're going to meet the targets that the Scottish Government has set out in the Programme for Government. But I think the commitment to expansion is definitely a step in the right direction. Even before the pandemic, a quarter of parents had given up work due to the cost of childcare, and Scotland has some of the most expensive childcare in the UK, which itself has some of the most expensive childcare in the world. So absolutely something to support, but we need to be more ambitious and think about how we can really meet all parents' needs through our provision.
Thank you very much indeed, Ailey. Next set of questions from Jeremy Balfour, please.
Good morning, panel, and thank you for your answers so far. I wonder if I can move us on to looking at income maximisation, particularly around the change that we're going to be having here in Scotland, with more benefits being run from Scotland and also benefits being run from Westminster. Even before the pandemic, there was lots of figures out there about how much money was not being taken up because people weren't applying for it. I suppose if I can start with John, if that's okay, just ask you, and maybe the other panel want to jump in. How do we here in Scotland maximise the benefit take-up from people who you are dealing with? Because I'm just surprised how many people still don't know that they're entitled to benefit or different types of benefit.
Yeah, I think that's a vital comment, because the ability of Scotland to use its powers also depends on people being able to access that. And while I support the need for things like discretionary housing payments for those budgets to be increased, I do worry about the discretionary nature of them, and therefore that exacerbates the issue that you're raising. I mean, I think we're in a position now where the risk of eviction is very, very high. And where we've seen some success is where, for example, in job centres, there has been good integration of job centre staff, people dealing with benefits and people dealing with housing, and making sure those things are better joined up, better integrated. Because I think particularly this time, and this is always the case, supporting someone to ensure they have housing stability has got to be almost a prerequisite then to supporting them into employment and making sure they get the benefits, the social security support that they need along the way. So I think that's what I say. Let's make sure we're not dealing with housing over here, and we're dealing with welfare over here, and we're dealing with employment over here. That integration is important, because then people will be able to access, and it will be more automatic that they will access the support they need. So I think that risk of repetition, I would just say that the longevity issue is important as well. Things like tenant support hardship grant funding needs to be extended. But the key thing for me is that we're helping people with housing stabilisation rather than going straight to employment when that's not the right thing for them, and making sure we join up those public services.
Thank you, John. On income maximisation, I can see Laurie and Satbat also look to come in here, so bring Laurie in first, please.
Thanks, Convener. I think the income maximisation piece is really important, and I think, as has been stated, I think there is an issue around uptake, and I would say that ultimately, it comes down to public awareness. There's two parts to that. I think one, it's people are simply they don't know what payments exist that could support them. I know there's in our written evidence. There's two case studies which our welfare advice team supplied, where they had gone through an income maximisation process, and it was a difference of several hundred pounds to those households in question. Which is a massive impact on a family's ability to then cope with problem debt. So there's a significant challenge there, I think, for the Scottish Government to address how it reaches out ultimately, because I think too often, and all sectors are guilty of this, I think there's sometimes expecting people to come to us first. Actually, we need to reach out. Government needs to reach out to let people know what their entitlement is, because I think there's a big issue around that. The second order issue to that, though, is I think stigma plays a significant part of this. It certainly does in terms of people accessing debt advice, and benefit uptake, welfare payment uptake, I think, is also linked in with this. And again, that comes down to how we talk about welfare, how we communicate about welfare, how the government does that, and what channels that were used. John made a really good point earlier about having integrated responses rather than seeing social security over here, debt advice over here, housing support over here. We've actually got to integrate these things, because they're all, certainly from the problem debt perspective, they're all thoroughly intertwined. And actually, if we can provide debt advice to a client and help them maximise their income at the same time, you know, this is one of the prime tenets of debt advice, that's absolutely key. So we do really need to have a strong focus on income maximisation.
Thank you very much indeed, Laurie. Satwat, followed briefly as well by Ailey, please.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll be very brief, because a lot of the points have been covered, but just to say, I absolutely agree. One of the big issues that comes up for the single parents that we work with is stigma and attitudes, and how that can put them off at times from seeking help and information and advice. So we really do need to look to see how we can get the debt, money and welfare rights advice firmly located within communities with trusted organisation intermediaries, where you might go already for something, where you know the individual worker, because it is a very, very complex system to try to navigate. And actually, a lot of these application processes for some of the sort of like benefits, UK benefits, are not simple. And you do require support to be able to navigate that. And some parents may start off themselves and then think, oh, actually, I can't do this, and then put it to one side. So I would say ease of application is critical. So anything we're developing here in Scotland, and Social Security Scotland do go out and work with groups to check out application processes. We'd welcome that sort of thing, so we get something that's simple to fill in, easy to fill in, with the right information, advice and support. And I think the point that's been made already around integration, there has to be coherence, and we need to look to see how we can simplify processes to ensure that the families we work with are getting what they're entitled to.
Thank you, Satwat. Ailey.
Thank you. The only point I will add is that a lot of the conversations around take-up and maximisation have to have regard to the access of data and evidence that is still collected largely at household level, and the quality of data that we have about who actually we need to be targeting some of these measures towards, both in the design of payment and in some of the signposting programmes, but we might come back into the conversation in detail later, I suppose.
Thank you very much. Mr Balfour has a brief supplementary.
A yes, no answer might suffice for this one. I'm conscious we now have Scottish Government providing some benefits and UK providing other benefits, and that can mean two different websites, a lot more websites than that. Would it be helpful, in your view, for the people that you're working with, to have one website which had all the benefits somebody could apply for, and it could be all done on one site, rather than having to go through lots of different websites or go to lots of different forms? If all the information was in one place, would that make benefit uptake more likely? Well, whoever wants to go, I don't mind. Ailey?
Thank you. I have no particular view on this. I think having multi-channels has been quite effective, but I can see arguments for streamlining.
Satwat.
Just very briefly, I would say the same as what Ailey has said, but just add to that that what's critical in all these things is having specialist advisors working alongside families when they are going through applying for various benefits. I think that advice and the information and the being able to talk through things is critical and is going to be one of the key ways that we can look to see how we can maximise take up of these benefits, is to make sure it's a supported process, irrespective of whether it's on one or multiple websites.
Thank you, Satwa. John, briefly.
Yeah, just very briefly, I think, I mean, whether that's the right mechanism or not, I don't know, but I think it is important to remember that when people are reaching out for advice, for guidance, for support to access welfare, they may well be going through a very traumatic situation at that time. So anything that that makes it easier for them to access the help they need. And the sort of, I guess the cliche is the no wrong door approach, that just means that any public service they're accessing is able at least to signpost them to the support they might need for another part of their life, while recognising that they will be going through a very traumatic, stressful and difficult time when they're doing that.
Thank you very much indeed, John. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a couple of further questions with regards to debt and looking at kind of potential new models. We know from some of the evidence which you've provided as well around council tax debt, for example, being one of the first sometimes which starts to build up, and non-payment of council tax, which becomes problematic for people managing that debt. So I just wondered, in terms of potential changes which could be brought forward to deal effectively with debts like that, what the panel's view was. Maybe start with Laurie, and then specifically maybe on that council tax debt, I'd like to sort of know the whole panel's view. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, the council tax debt has been for years been a really pressing concern of ours. It's the most common priority area as in household expenditure area that people come to us with. It's the third most prevalent debt type that our clients have after credit cards and loans. It's council tax. The reason it causes such concern to us is because of the penalties for non-payment and how local authorities approach these. So, and I mean, I always try and caveat this that I'm not looking to bash local authorities here under incredibly difficult fiscal situation, as we're all aware. But the council tax burden on families who are struggling to pay. Often it feels like that first missed payment is like the first domino toppling, and it ends up in enforcement action, wage arrestment, and essentially a kind of level of enforcement action that is available to public sector creditors, you know, HMRC, DWP, how they're able to collect debt, which no no commercial lender would be able to do. And also, clients can be put in a situation where they're having to repay it way above a level that is affordable for them. So I think, crucially, we need to get in after that first domino, and we also need to make sure that there's an integration between advice and collections within local authorities. We worked on a best practice toolkit with the Improvement Service, which we launched just before the pandemic, which I'm sure we'll both be revisiting, that looked at, obviously, with 32 local authorities, there's 30 different ways in which this is done, that looked at the best ways of actually communicating with local authority residents who were struggling with council tax, and recognising that mispayment on council tax is evidence of wider problems and wider difficulties, rather than focusing specifically on that one difficulty. So I think we need to get advice integrated. I think there's also an issue, and not to get too into the long grass with this, but if we look at council tax reduction, someone may be in receipt of the full council tax reduction. They're not liable to pay council tax, and the client will go forward with that understanding. But there's they do not have the full reduction for water and sewage charges that are billed with their council tax. So they are getting this bill in that they think they're exempt from, not understanding that this is the water and sewage cost. So actually, one way of looking at this is getting to look at where we can get the full reduction for someone who's in getting full council tax reduction. I mean, this certainly leads to confusion, and you have clients who will say, oh, well, I'm not liable to pay council tax. Obviously, this is an error. And in the meantime, they are liable, and this debt's mounting in the background. And of course, local authorities too are having to spend resources. It's a significant amount of money. I mean, sheriff officers, it's not cheap. This is debt enforcement at a cost. And that's why we are sort of urging towards a more sort of preventative approach and addressing where the issues are. And also linking back to my earlier points around the tenant support hardship grant, understanding that renters particularly are not just going to be in difficulty with that one bill. We need to view the whole issue holistically and try to sort of interdict that process, because it does move very quickly. Obviously, the first bill's missed, the full amount for the year's then billed, and for someone who's in problem debt and desperately trying to struggle things, the choice then becomes, well, do I extend high cost credit further, which I know is unaffordable, or do I miss this bill that is the real penalties? And people understand we've done research with clients, the hierarchy in which bills are, they know that rent, council tax and utilities costs are their first priority. They understand the importance of these. But really what results when we take this sort of heavy enforcement action is a debt spiral that worsens and worsens as someone uses high cost credit, for instance, to cover one of these essential bills. Next month things are no better. They need to extend more credit and more credit upon more credit, with spiralling interest costs, until someone hits that point of crisis. So we need to prevent people hitting that point of crisis.
Thank you, Lauren. Of course, that debt spiral is exacerbated when you consider that sheriff officers' costs are added to the arrears of the tenant rather than being absorbed by the local authority or whoever the case may be. Mr. Briggs, do you have a supplementary, and then I'll bring in Mr. Sparks.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, it was specifically looking at concerns yesterday about energy costs. You know, we know in one day gas prices jumped 40%. Now, that impact will probably be next spring, but my question was really specifically around preventative models. And I know, John, you touched upon this in terms of what we can do around homelessness preventative models. But in terms of debt management and preventative models, do any of the panel have any suggestions around that? And specifically, you know, consumer advice is very much readily available online, but for people who do not have access to online services or have maybe reading difficulties as well, where should we sort of be looking at taking some of the work around that? Happy to maybe start with John, and if anyone else wants to come in Thanks, Convener.
Yeah, so my response is partly relating to Laurie's previous response, but just to reinforce that and join some things together. I think Laurie's comment about this possibly sometimes being the first of a domino, I think was really important. And just to join that to the forthcoming consultation on homelessness prevention, you know, if that is the first domino, then that duty on public services to start action to prevent homelessness 6 months out, this is likely to be the trigger for that. And of course, it's a local authority debt, and the actions around homelessness prevention will sit with the same local authority. So this isn't even joining up across different public services. This is joining up across the same organisations. But I think it just reinforces the need for really good debt advice at the earliest possible opportunity, both to deal with the issue of spiralling debt, but ultimately to avoid that person, that household becoming homeless with all of the human and economic costs that go with that.
Thank you, John. Laurie, and then Satwat, please.
Thank you, Convener. The energy issue is a huge concern. I mean, we knew that there's obviously going to be wider inflationary pressures, as well as looking at support measures sort of failing to fade away. So we are looking at a really concerning period where people, particularly this winter, but as you say, the pressure rise will likely be next spring. So I think early advice is really important. I think we need to look at what duties we place on providers as well. You know, what kind of approach are they taking to clients? Are they communicating with their clients in a sort of preventative way? Are they saying, if you're in difficulty, please talk to us about this? We know that ultimately that energy increases can be difficult. Can we look more widely at the role of regulators here around prices? I mean, the price caps rise obviously is concerning, and these huge increases will be passed on to consumers. So I think we need to try and get a bit of a handle on how that market's operating. We've made a big deal about freedom of choice and switching your energy supplier. But if you switch your energy supplier right now, you're going to be paying far more than you would have been. So I think we've really got to make sure we get advice in there early. And again, avoid people having to make these choices between heating and eating, because that's the reality of the choice people are making now, particularly with £20 less a week on the universal credit. So we've actually got to see the utilities costs again as being built into this wider pressure. And I think, I mean, there's an actual focus on people in poverty here, and we make a brief point as well about precarity here. So vast majority of our clients are in work, though this can be precarious work, and that's what makes the challenge for them budgeting month to month so difficult. And that's why they fall into problem debt, because they've had steady commitments that they've been able to manage, but then things have been thrown into the difficulty. So we have to actually understand that adding these energy bills on doesn't just affect people who are in the most extreme poverty, but also is going to affect people right across income brackets. And this new group of people who have fallen into difficulty in the pandemic, who haven't accessed advice before, and aren't necessarily aware of the pathways, we've got to think quite carefully about how we get access there. Though I think your point around digital literacy and general literacy actually is also really crucial, that we need to have multi-format and multi-channel avenues of support for people. I think that's really crucial.
Thank you, Laurie. Satwat, please. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Just very quickly, building on that, in terms of the early intervention, the prevention, what we can do. I think it comes back to looking at how we develop whole family support models, and the support for families includes the specialist information and advice around income maximisation, and also if there is debt and problem debt, what we can do with that, because it is complex. It isn't something that many of us would feel confident going in and advising on, but it is part of saying, actually, do you know, if we're looking at whole I mean, there's a budget commitment of a family wellbeing fund. And I think when we're looking at family wellbeing, we need to look at it in the whole, in terms of emotional wellbeing, but also in terms of, you know, sort of financial wellbeing, and support with debt needs to be integrated into the other support that we have for families. So there's no longer that, you know, we're looking to see how we can minimise the stigma around this and around talking about this, and being able to start that conversation with somebody who you trust, who you have a relationship with, I think is critical to people being able to speak about it at an early stage, you know, as opposed to when, as colleagues have said so eloquently, when it becomes overwhelming.
Thank you very much indeed. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. This first question is for Crisis. In terms of poverty proofing, which we've discussed a lot as a committee, what do you feel that lack of poverty proofing has led to historically? And can you see from legislation so far in this Parliament and from the last Parliament what the impact of having input from people with lived experience is having on preventing homelessness?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, we've seen the impact, I would say, in some of those figures that I've talked about, you know, the record high levels of temporary accommodation, and the fact that I think probably even more crucially than that, that 15% of people who are experiencing homelessness have previously experienced homelessness within the last 5 years. So clearly there is a cycle of poverty that hasn't been broken. I mean, I think there is significant progress in relation to this in Scotland, but that needs to continue. So everything I've talked about homelessness prevention needs to continue. Those the provisions that the Scottish Government is able to put in place using its own social security powers are vital, as the link to poverty, between poverty and homelessness is very, very, very clear. It's not just about housing; it's about the ability to afford the housing. I think I think a lot of that is either in place or coming. I think the work of local authorities around rapid rehousing has been absolutely vital. Just reconfiguring everything they're doing to permanent settled homes, which are the basis for people to move on, move out of poverty, move out of homelessness, rather than managing homelessness through temporary accommodation. The change of emphasis is around preventing and ending. I think the only other thing I would just say is that we do need to also look at the disproportionate impact on different groups. This isn't a homogeneous group. We've talked about the impact on women and the cause of homelessness in relation to women. In relation to men, they are more likely to experience repeat homelessness, so more likely to be in that cycle of poverty and homelessness, and more likely to sleep rough as well. So the nature of support for people is different, and also for people from Black, Asian, and minoritised ethnic groups, there's a disproportionate effect as well. So 87% So 80% of homelessness is for white individuals when they make up 95% of the population. So there's clearly a disproportionate impact there. So many of the prevention mechanisms and debt and poverty avoidance mechanisms are universal, but they also need to be focused on those higher risk.
Satwat and Ailey, there's been a real focus on much of the evidence that we've received so far on the importance of lived experience. In terms of child poverty, is it enough to speak to the parents, or do we need to hear from kids who are currently in poverty, or folk who are kids who grew up in poverty?
Satwat.
Thank you very much. I think we need to hear from the whole family. I think we need to look to see how we can support children and young people to engage. And actually, there are some really good initiatives that people have done to ensure that children and young people are an integral part of designing the solutions and not just defining the problem. the work that Child Poverty Action Group have done on cost of the school day, for example, and things like that, very specific initiatives involving children and young people. I think what's important about involving experts by experience and those with lived experience is that we see it as an end-to-end process. Not at the beginning, you know, it's not after we've had the chat, gone away and done something and come back and saying we're going to do this, but it's an end-to-end. It's a sort of collaborative design process that we're looking at here. Where testing happens by individuals from the six priority family groups within, you know, the child poverty sphere, say what is the impact of this actually going to be, how is this going to land in your life, do you know, what matters to you, what's going to make a difference to you. So we're actually doing effective co-production, co-design with solutions that are going to, which the families feel are going to work for them and believe can work for them. And you can only do that if you look in the whole and work with the whole family, from very young children right up to the parents. But I do think that it is making a difference. I think we are going to begin to look at policies, actions and finances for the lens of how it's going to impact on those in poverty. I'm not going to speak about the gender budgeting, etc. I'm going to leave that to Ailey, who's much more expert in this than I am. But all that effect, I think, will be effective, but it is going to take time to bed in, because it's about changing how we currently work to something which is going to be more effective in the long run, but potentially more resource intensive to do so.
Thank you very much, Satwat. Ailey, please.
Thank you very much. And to echo everything Satwat said about participation and genuine participation in co-production, I think in order to do that effectively, particularly when it comes to women, we do have to make sure that facilitators have the gender competence that, that enables them to understand how access to income is different for women, how the impact of men's violence and different standards of health and well-being that women experience all interact with one another to affect women's material conditions and the ability that they then might have to participate in some of those discussions and some of the dynamics that can manifest within discussions. So having women-only sessions, for example, is something that women often talk about when interacting with kind of lived experience programmes. I also think there needs to be a bit of a question around how to combine that gender competence or other competence with experience or experts by experience perspectives, because one individual's perspective is only their perspective, no matter the extent to which it is inevitably informed by the structural discrimination and oppression. So there's a bit of a balance we need to still have a conversation around how to frame individual experience, particularly when we're talking about things like poverty, which are so, poverty is so gendered. There are so many structural barriers to income and health and well-being, and we just maybe need to have a bit of a mind to how these all fit together in an effective way to really give us a true and accurate picture.
Thank you, Ailey. Final question in this session is from Faisal Chowdhury, please.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask what percentage of BME families with children are claiming the new benefit, i.e. Scottish Child Payments?
Any particular?
Anyone. Satwat, I can see you're shaking your head.
I can see Ailey looking to come in.
I'm very happy for Satwat to come in first. The honest answer is I don't have figures to hand to tell you, but the quality of the data that we do have is still very, very new. For a long time, when it comes to Scottish benefits, we didn't ask mandatory questions around protected characteristics. That was changed in 2019. Obviously, the Scottish Child Payment has rolled out much more recently than that. So I don't have figures to hand, but there are maybe broader questions we could return to around the quality of data and how much we can actually gather from the data that is currently being collected and monitored.
Any other?
I don't know if Satwat has more accurate figures than I do.
I don't have any figures, apologies, but it may be something that the committee will want to ask those who are administering the benefit to see whether they've got that disaggregated data. Because I think it's critical that we are driven by how it's working currently to look to see where we need to improve either communication about it or support to ensure that the take-up of the Scottish Child Payment is as far-reaching as it can be, and we're getting to as many families as we can. Apologies for not having the stats to hand, but certainly I do think it's something with the agencies who are administering it, it's a level of analysis that needs to be done in an ongoing way to inform the rollout of the benefit and the publicity and the targeting of support for people to be able to claim the benefit.
Thank you very much indeed to all of our witnesses this morning for taking the time to answer all of our questions in such an informed and helpful manner. Very grateful for your time and also for your written submissions as well, which will form a large part of our consideration over the coming weeks. So thank you very much indeed. I now suspend briefly to allow for a change of our witnesses. Thank you. I'd like to welcome to the meeting our next panel. We have Claire Murdoch, Head of Social Security and Public Funding at the Scottish Fiscal Commission, Professor Alistair Smith, Commissioner at the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and also joining us remotely, Professor David Ulf, who is also a Commissioner on the Scottish Fiscal Commission. I'd like to invite Professor Smith to make a brief opening statement, please, and then we'll take questions from there.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for this invitation to this evidence session. It's our pleasure to be here, and we look forward to working with the committee throughout this parliamentary session. We recently published two reports which should help inform the committee's pre-budget scrutiny. In July, we published our forecast evaluation report, which looked back at the forecasts that we made in February 2020 of social security spending in 2020-21. I'll refer to this report briefly at the end of these opening remarks, but first, let me summarise our most recent economic and fiscal forecasts, which we published in August. We saw then the outlook for the Scottish economy as having improved significantly since our February 2021 forecast. In our August forecast, we have GDP getting back to its pre-pandemic level in the second quarter of 2022, and the unemployment rate peaking at 5.4% in the last quarter of this calendar year. Now, we don't know exactly how the labour market will develop now that the furlough scheme has ended, but we don't expect significant changes in eligibility for devolved social security payments from this. But one element in our economic forecasts which does affect social security spending is inflation, because many social security payments are increased by inflation each year. Significant price rises have been a recent feature of the Scottish and UK economies, and in our August forecast, we said that, like the Bank of England, we expected inflation would peak at 4% by the end of this year. The number of people receiving support also rises over time. Because of this, together with inflation, we're predicting that spending on devolved social security payments will increase from £3.7 billion in 21-22 to £5.2 billion in 2026-27. The overall outlook for the Scottish budget is still very uncertain, and our forecasts are just one component of that budget. The UK government's budget on the 27th of October and the associated updated forecasts from the Office of Budget Responsibility will determine the level of block grant funding to the Scottish Government next year, including the block grant adjustment for Social Security. So, turning to our forecasts in more detail, from next summer, the Scottish Government will gradually be replacing the UK Government's personal independence payment, PIP, with its own adult disability payment, ADP. This is a major step in the devolution of social security, and for the first time, we've estimated the additional spending associated with it. Although there are no changes in the overall structure of the payment as we move from PIP to ADP, there are significant changes in the processes for application, review, and appeals, and in how the payment is promoted. We expect that by 2026-27, spending on ADP will reach £3 billion, which is about half a billion higher than would have been spent on PIP. We also expect spending on carers' allowance to increase as more people become eligible through the larger numbers of adults receiving disability payments. The Scottish Government receives funding from the UK Government based approximately on what would have been spent on PIP in Scotland. So the additional spending on ADP and carers' allowance will need to be met within the Scottish budget by raising taxes or by reducing spending elsewhere. Spending on the Scottish Child Payment, a payment not funded by the UK Government, is forecast to increase to £165 million in 2023-24, following the rollout to children under 16. After this point, we expect spending to be broadly flat, with uprating increases offset by a falling child population. But that's on existing policies for Scottish child payment. And my last remark about social security spending is a reminder that the Scottish Government also has other commitments to increase social security spending, including, importantly, the doubling of Scottish child payment. And we've yet to include these changes in our forecasts. Finally, our forecast evaluation report shows that spending was £100 million higher in 2020-21 than we expected when the budget was set. That's a 3% forecast error. About half of that increase is because of increased Scottish Government spending in response to the pandemic. Our forecasts are by their nature uncertain, and forecast errors are likely to be larger when we're looking at new payments. Next year's budget will include both the new child disability payment and adult disability payment. Initially, we expect, therefore, higher forecast errors because we have only limited information to guide our estimates of how the delivery innovations will affect the caseload and average payments. But in time, these forecast errors should reduce as we get figures for actual expenditure. We're now happy to answer any questions that you have for us, and convener, if it's helpful, I'm happy to direct questions to David and to Claire, and indeed to myself if I have to.
I appreciate that direction, Professor Smith, which will help us with our timely progress through this session. First set of questions are from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I have to say that the papers that were provided in advance of today were really, really helpful, including your own submission. And I hope that I've had enough grasp of what is a complex paper and area to get a hold of to ask something that is useful. The first question I have is around the forecasting within the fiscal context. And I wonder how much advance notice of policy implementation or policy intention do you normally get or would you expect in order to be able to forecast for something going forward?
Well, I suppose it's useful to answer that in relation to social security spending. So, Claire, do you want to address that?
So I suppose there's sort of two parts to the question. Is how much notice do we have and what level of detail do we need? So effectively, once the government tells us what their firm policy is, we can include that in our forecast as long as it's within the five-year horizon. But I'm assuming your question might relate to, for example, the Scottish Child Payment, in which case we would need to know when they plan to double it, how they plan to double it, what the rates will be in each year, and then we would include that in our forecast. In terms of when we get information from the government, when we have the Scottish Budget, for example, we start the process 10 weeks in advance and we go to the government and we say, can you tell us what your policies are going to be to include in the budget? And the government have an opportunity to tell us what they can tell us firmly at that time. So anything that they can will be in the budget, we will include in our forecasts. If there are other policy changes made during the year, the government can come to us and tell us if they plan to make changes through legislation. And then if it's not at the right time for us to do it in a budget forecast, we'll do a supplementary costing to accompany the legislation to make sure that Parliament has access to an independent forecast of any policy changes the government is making.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's really helpful. So if you're not or you haven't yet forecast for the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment, is it unlikely that the Scottish Child Payment will be doubled in this budget?
We haven't, because we are currently in the middle of our 10, at the start of our 10-week process in the run-up to the budget, we will be asking the government what their plans are. So we will be able to tell you on the 9th of December whether the government are including it or not. At this point in time, we wouldn't necessarily know. It sometimes happens as we get closer to the budget.
Thank you. And just following on from the point you made earlier about being able to do a supplementary forecast, does that mean that if there was a decision or a policy change between budgets, there would be the information available to government to be able to adjust their spending appropriately?
So we will produce a costing or a forecast, should I say, of the spending if it's a change which is being made to legislation. So we don't produce a forecast every time the government says they want to introduce a new policy, otherwise we wouldn't stop working at any point. But if the government was to say this is our policy change and we are introducing the legislation to Parliament to implement that change, then we would produce a forecast at that point in time.
Thank you. And finally, Convener, if I can, as the government gradually uses or chooses to use more powers in social security, it's going to need to carry out similar forecasting exercises before taking decisions, presumably, on how to do things differently than the UK. What discussions have you had with the government on forecasting further changes to social security, and have any particular areas of potential spend for new benefits been identified?
I'm not sure that we really discuss in the way that your question implies future forecasts with the government, because it's our job to do the forecast. So it's more of a hands off dialogue. So if when the government has formulated its policy towards Scottish Child Payment, or if some of the other policies which are currently managed by DWP get handed over to the Scottish Government, then the process is that the Scottish Government tells us what its policy is going to be. We make the forecast either at the time of the budget or, as Claire said, sometimes outside the budget cycle. But it's then up to the Government, in discussion with Parliament, not with us, to work out how the increased expenditure is going to be managed within the budget.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Next set of questions are from Jeremy Balfour, please.
And good morning, panel. Nice to see you back. I would like to just pursue this kind of differential that you see coming forward with the Scottish Government taking moving PIP to adult, because the regulations are pretty well similar for both benefits, so there's going to be no differential there. So could you just give me a wee bit more on why you think it will cost more? And then secondly, out of that, if take-up is higher, this may be at your remit, and if it is, I apologise, but if take-up is higher, will that have to be met by Scottish Government, or can they go back to your government and say another 5,000 people have applied for this benefit, can you give us the money for it? And how do the governments work that one out on, was it just natural take-up, or was it a deliberate policy decision?
Well, that's a very important question or set of questions, because our forecast at ADP is going to, at the end of the five-year period, cost a lot more than PIP is probably the biggest single element in our forecast. So I'm going to hand these important and tricky questions over to David to have a go at.
Thank you, Alistair. There were a number of steps we went through to forecast the implications of the changes in which the way the Scottish Government plans to deliver ADP. So the first thing we did was we looked around to see if there were any equivalent changes in benefits that we could rely on as a way of trying to gauge the extent of this expenditure. So, for example, we looked at the shift from DLA to PIP to see whether that gave us any comparable lessons. However, in many cases, there was nothing that was exactly comparable to what we're seeing in the proposals. I think the important point to make here is that there were a significant number of different changes that were being proposed by the Scottish Government. So in our forecasting effort, we broke that down into 9 separate elements that we thought we had to understand in order to come to a forecast. And for each of those elements, we first of all, as I said, tried to see if there was anything comparable that we could use as the basis of coming to a number. But then when there wasn't anything like that, we had to make a judgment. And being a judgment, of course, that is potentially liable to error. What we did was we then shared our judgments with both people in Social Security Scotland, with people in the Scottish Government, and with other people who are experienced in forecasting. We set out all our judgments, and we listened very carefully to the comments and criticism that they had of those judgments. And we then sometimes modified our assessments and judgments in the light of those comments. For example, quite an important component of our increase in funding for ADP comes because we have forecast that there will be an increase in the average level of payment from moving from PIP to ADP. And the basis for that was that when we moved from DLA to PIP, we saw that 43% of people had an increase in payment. On an average, payment went up by 19%. Now, we worked out by analysing the data that half of that increase was attributable to the fact that when moving from DLA to PIP, there was a change in the rates of payment. So if you eliminate that change in payment rates, then the remaining half was due simply to the fact that people moved across from one benefit to another. And following discussions with the various groups of people with whom we were talking, at the end of the day, we came to a figure for 8% as being the increase in the average level of payment award that would arise because of the transition in the way in which this the benefit was being administered. So that was the way in which we went about systematically looking at all the various components of the change in policy, thinking through what the potential impact was on the number of people who might claim, the timing of when those people would claim, how long people would remain on benefits for, what the impact of the change in definition of terminal illness was. We went through each and every one of those elements of the proposed changes, thought our way through the potential implications, looked for evidence, shared our thinking with our colleagues in other institutions, other organisations, and then modified our judgments in the light of what we heard from them. So that, I think, answers your question about how we went about arriving at our judgment. I don't think we can necessarily help you on the question of how do you sort out whether this is attributable to originally to PIP or to ADB. I think given that this is part of what we forecast as attributable to the shift to ADB, it will be part of this, it will fall on the Scottish budget at the end of the day. I'm not sure there is any scope to go back and say this wasn't attributable to what we did as Scottish policy.
If I can just follow up with two very quick supplementaries. First one is, with the transfer being, and I think what we're trying to do safe and secure is a kind of terminology that's used a lot, is that everybody that's on PIP will just transfer straight across. Are you then forecasting once people are transferred across, they will look to review that decision and thus you will see people moving from a different rate to a higher rate? And secondly, is your expectation that there are a number, a substantial number of people out there who are not applying for PIP, but will apply for this different benefit? And I'm just wondering why that is the case. Is it because they're holding off because they think they have more chance with the new agency? Is it going to be an advertising awareness course? So I'm just wondering, how did you come to that, if you did come to that conclusion? Maybe clear, I don't know.
Okay, well...
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Professor Wolf.
Okay, well, certainly one, Jeremy, in answer to the first part of your question, certainly one part of what we thought was going on here was that when people would be moved across, they might challenge the level of benefit that they were being awarded. So we thought there might be a rise in the number of challenges. We also thought that there could be some process by which people who'd been turned down for PIP might now start to apply for ADP. But there is also just a sense that if people anticipate that this benefit will be administered in a different way, that they will have more support in applying for it, that there'll be a wider range of evidence that they can provide in order to support their application. This could allow people, or this could encourage people to apply who otherwise would not have applied, so there would have been some increase in take-up. And so we did forecast there would be a significant increase in the overall caseload for ADP as a result of the switch from PIP to ADP. So there were a number of different components which fed through into our thinking and the way in which that would actually operate. But as I say, for each of those components, we looked at evidence as to what would provide a number. We provided our judgments, we shared our judgments with other people, and we modified our judgments in the light of comments we got from other people. I hope that answers your question.
Because this is a very important issue, monetarily and in a policy way, can I add to David's answer in a different kind of way and quote what the Cabinet Secretary for Finance said in response to our forecast when we published it? She said, we, that's the Scottish Government, are delivering a social security service based on dignity, fairness and respect rather than taking an austerity level approach as the UK Government has done, where all that matters is driving down the cost of supporting those who need it
most. Social Security is an investment in the people of Scotland. We're committed to making sure everyone can access the financial support that we're entitled to. The objectives of the... I mean, we obviously make no comment on that, the policy as a policy. It's stated there by the Cabinet Secretary. But in forecasting what the effects of that policy would be, we have to... We took the intention behind the policy seriously, and it's clearly the intention of the Scottish Government in designing its social security, devolved social security policies, that people, everyone who's entitled to payments should receive them. And it's reasonable to suppose that if that policy is successful, there will be an increase in take-up rates. And that's fed in the way that David has described in detail into our forecasts.
That's very helpful. And following briefly on from Mr Balfour's questions before I bring in Marie McNair, how, given that there is such a large additional spend associated, from your perspective, purely on the smoother, more supported application process, before we get to a policy change position, how important, from your perspective, was it that, given that the additional amount has to come from elsewhere in the Scottish budget, for the safe and secure transfer that Mr Balfour talks about, how important in that perspective was it that the Scottish Government took the process this way round, rather than changing that, the eligibility for ADP, but moving it to a case transfer process first from a fiscal position?
Clear.
I suppose from a forecasting perspective, all these changes are going to be difficult to forecast, and there is a high level of uncertainty attached to our forecast. If you make the more changes you make at any point in time, the more difficult it is to expect, understand what's changing and what the effect will be. So by changing the way the government have done it, they've changed the way they deliver it, the way they administer it, we think that will increase spending. If the eligibility is to change, that will obviously change the spending in the future. We hope that when Social Security Scotland are administering the payment, they will be collecting data that we can then use to make sure that when future costings are done, we can look at how many people are receiving it and how many, you can get more information on which categories they've become eligible for the payment based on. So then if things are changed, we have more data about the Scottish claimants as well.
Thank you, that's helpful. Marie McNair, please.
Good morning, panel. The removal of the £20 universal credit uplift will take many out of UC and therefore eligibility for the Scottish child payment. How has this been factored into your projections?
It is indeed the case that the £20 change, which obviously has a big impact across the whole population of people receiving universal credit, takes some people out of eligibility for benefits. But the effect on devolved social security expenditure is actually relatively small. It's a very significant change, but it doesn't have a very significant impact on our forecasts.
We factored it into our eligibility estimates for the Scottish Child Payment, and I saw the Cabinet Secretary wrote to you last week, I think, and said that they estimate 2,000 children would no longer be receiving the Scottish Child Payment, and that's a number that we would agree with.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. Next set of questions will come from Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. And as my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy said, I think the briefing you provided has been really useful when we're trying to get into granular detail of some of the cost projections around new benefits and also setting up of services. I wanted to ask two specific questions. One with regards to Social Security Scotland's costs and forecasting you did originally, you looked at the government's potential costs around that, which I believe were set at £307 million, which have now doubled to over £651 million. Just wondered if you had any insight into those costs and where forecasting may have gone wrong by the government around the initial setup costs. And then secondly, a question with regards to adult disability payments. How you think the forecasting, which from the information you've given committee doesn't seem to be clear, the scale of uncertainty around that, and just wondering what impact do you think that might have on wider Social Security Scotland and the benefits they currently administer?
Well, Claire, do you want to take the first question?
I'll answer the first question briefly. We only forecast the amount of spending on the payments which are made to people. We don't get involved in forecasting Social Security Scotland's administration budget. That's for the Scottish Government. So any questions on how that budget is set or what the forecasts are based on should be directed to the government rather than us. Alistair, do you want to take?
Well, and as far as risks in the ADP forecast are concerned, thank you for your complimentary comments about the briefing. And I hope, I'm pleased that it did make it clear that the ADP forecast, for all of the detailed reasons that David talked about a few minutes ago, has got a very high degree of uncertainty in it, because we cannot know exactly, even approximately, how many of the things are going to work out. It's our best guess. But the comfort in it all is that the biggest, these changes are going to accumulate over time, and it's towards the end of the five-year period that we see the big changes coming. So over that five-year period, we and the Scottish Government will get information about how ADP is working and CD, child disability payment as well, and be able to make more reliable forecasts, so that if it turns out, for example, that the estimates which we've made for how it's going to be in 2026-27 turn out to be accurate, the government has got a period of years in which to work out how to incorporate those estimates into their budget. And it's as well that they do, because it's really important to understand two things about how we think about the Social Security budget, which is that as it grows over time, you know, it's not growing over time for reasons of arithmetic, it's growing over time because once some people become eligible for ADP payments in 1 year, most of them are going to be in the bill for next year, and the people who join the programme in the next year will then be in the following year. So the programme accumulates in a way, and once you've learned the commitments you have, your government has got them for the longer run, and doesn't have the option of cutting back on them when it finds people who are eligible for payment, doesn't have the option of cutting back in other areas of the Social Security budget if the ADP budget ends up bigger than it expected, because in the other areas of Social Security, the payments are to people who are entitled to them. So it's all a, you know, quite a big budgetary challenge, as we have tried to emphasise in our report. But the government has got time to think about how, for example, if in the end it does have to make budget adjustments or tax adjustments elsewhere, and the budget adjustments would probably have to be, for the reasons I've just indicated, not in the Social Security budget, but in other budgets. It's got time to make those decisions.
That's very helpful. Thank you. And it answered my question in regards to when you would expect, you know, that uncertainty to be clear. So you think a sort of five-year projection once the benefit is established, I think, was your answer to that. Specifically looking at some of the drivers around increased costs, you'd outlined additional successful applications and also higher average payments. Are there any other areas which you think also are important to make sure the Scottish Government is aware of, and for this committee to maybe investigate as well, to look at the long-term sustainability around payments?
David, are there any other areas you'd like to highlight for us?
I'm conscious of the fact that Professor Olf was looking to come in at an earlier stage as well, so perhaps you could answer both sections there, Professor Olf.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. So in answer to this particular question, the three big drivers of increased costs are the increase in the number of awards that we think will be given, which adds 164 million to the budget, the increase in the average awards, which I talked about before, which adds 104. And then we also thought there'd be an initial spike in applications once the program's introduced, which would add about 83 million. So those are the three big drivers of the increase in costs. But I do want to go back to the point that Alistair made about the persistence of this increase in costs, that once people get onto ADP, then they will stay on ADP potentially for quite a long time, and there will be future upratings of inflation, which will make the cost of this grow as well. So part of what's driving the difference between PIP spending and total ADP spending is our forecast also for future levels of the inflationary uprate that will take place here. So I think those are the main points I wanted to make in answer to your question.
Just to be clear, Professor Ulf, is that regard in terms of people remaining on ADP for longer, is that because of the difference between PIP and ADP and expectation of longer awards?
Well, that is certainly part of it. It is certainly part of it. But by the nature of ADP itself, it's not a one-off payment. Once people become eligible for ADP, they will remain eligible for a period of time. And that has to be factored into one of the things that's going to be driving up costs, but also the changes in the review period, that will have an effect on the length of time that people remain on the benefit as well.
Thank you very much. Next set of questions come from Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. Yeah, the difference between the cost of PIP and ADP is quite significant. Do you expect that if Social Security was to be devolved in entirety, that the costs of delivering the benefits would be less?
As Claire said, it's not our job to get involved in commenting on the government's costs and the delivery of the programme. We focus on what the cost is of the programme. I mean, the cost is of the payments from the programme, not the government's costs.
Okay. Anybody else with any supplementaries at this stage? Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks again for your responses to mine and other questions. Your paper notes the significant challenges around the adult disability payment, and we've heard about a lot of them today in terms of the predictions and the volatility around it. Can you tell us a bit about what you've done to get the information that you've already got and what further information you think could help you with that? And I know, Claire, that your point around the data collection from Social Security Scotland, I think it would be really helpful for the committee to get a bit more understanding of the sort of data that you feel you will need in order to be able to predict costs into the future.
Claire, I think questions are directed at you.
Thank you. So, in terms of the data that we use at the moment, we have information on personal independence payment. We know how many people are receiving it. We know which level of award they have. We also know which sort of category they fall into, by which I mean whether they previously received DLA, whether they're a new claim, or whether they're in receipt for special rules if they have a terminal illness case. So we look at these different categories of people because they have slightly different characteristics in terms of how much they receive and how long they receive on the payment. When Social Security Scotland are delivering the payment, we would like the same information that we get from DWP, but we'd also, if it's possible, you know, additional information we use, for example, there's correlations between people's gender and people's age, and how so that affects how much people receive and how long they receive the payment for. So that type of information, and the information they have in terms of the level of award they're receiving for care or mobility, and in some cases, if we can have information, for example, on which points they scored, if there's a policy change, then we can assess how many people are more likely to fall under that sort of category of change than other people. So those are sort of the information that we're after from Social Security Scotland. In terms of the information that we used to forecast adult disability payment, David set out, we've spoken to a lot of different people. We asked the government, we obviously read their position papers. We've had discussions with colleagues in the OBR and DWP who have experience of forecasting the change from DLA to PIP. In terms of additional information that we could get at this point in time, I think we'll really need the payment to launch, and then we'll see what actually happens in practice. And then at that point, we can start to, I suppose, understand what it's like for people who are going through the application process as well. We'll see what that means for people applying, and then we'll see what that means for numbers in terms of how many people are receiving it from Social Security Scotland.
Thank you.
We've got another, Pam. Yep.
I do. Thank you, Convener. Thank you for that. That's really helpful. In terms of policy change, Professor Smith, you mentioned that the long-term approach to this would be needed given the finances involved. Would you have an idea of the sorts of timescales that would be needed in order to change any, for example, eligibility to adult disability payment? And when should the question start to be asked in order that the forecasting can be suitable and budgets can be moved as and where needed?
Well, I suppose the answer to that is because these budgets respond over time to policy changes, that the earlier thought is given to policy changes and their possible long-run effects, the better. Because one of the risks is that you make a change in policy that isn't very expensive in the first 2 or 3 years, and even this big shift to ADP doesn't start incurring big costs in the first couple of years. The costs come further down the line. The sooner you start thinking about those implications, the better. And that's going to be an issue not just with the policies that the Scottish Government has currently taken over, but when policies like attendance allowance are devolved to Scottish Government control, no doubt the Scottish Government will want to think about how they want those policies implemented. Indeed, they've already said that as further social security policies get devolved, they will want to change how they're administered. And it will be very important at that point for them to think about what are the long-run implications in the same way that we and they are thinking now about the long-run implications of ADP. And you need to think about them all together, because there may be trade-offs between some policies. Frankly, if the more you spend on some things, obviously the less you have to spend on other things. And with the expensive policies down the line, like attendance allowance, the big policies on the devolution agenda, a lot of them are associated with age and disability, and therefore they have this long-run property that both David and I were talking about. And they also have inherent uncertainties about them, because it's hard to predict. Even it helps when we have data, we do a better job of forecasting. But even when we look at established policies like PIP, where the UK government had data on PIP recipients, and nevertheless, when policies changed, they were surprised by the way the costs changed. So it's quite a challenge ahead as further policies get devolved to the Scottish Government.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I've got some supplementaries from Marie McNair, Miles Briggs, and then I've got a question myself as well.
Thank you, Convener. The process for assessing the adult disability payment will not use private sector assessments. Have you anticipated any movement in the costs associated with that policy change?
David, do you want to answer that question?
Well, it was certainly a factor that we took into account when thinking through the implications of the take-up assumptions that fit into our calculation of the lightning costs of ADP. We looked at the fact that people would be able to call on a wider range of support. And that was one of the factors that we thought about as being a driver for the increase in the potential take-up of ADP, and hence the increase in the caseload that we were forecasting. I don't think we ever went down specifically to that particular issue to which you were pointing. We just recognised that people could call on a wider range of support than was previously available, and that we thought would have an impact on the caseload. And we then tried to find numbers that would help us identify what, from the past experience, would be the potential increase in caseload associated with that widening of areas of support.
Said we considered the changes which were being made to the application and assessment process. We obviously don't consider the cost of that delivery. That's part of the Social Security Scotland versus CWP administration costs, which is for the government to consider.
Is the more compassionate approach been taken in Scotland around terminal illness claims a possible factor in some of the cost increase projected?
David again.
That was certainly something which we looked very hard at. The Scottish Government had done a Delphi analysis asking doctors how they might change their classification in the light of the changed rules. And we drew quite heavily on the findings from that Delphi study in coming to our views as to what the likely impact of that change in terminal illness would be on the ADP costs.
Thank you very much indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. It's a further question from my colleague, Marie McNair, to follow on from that, was around potential other benefits which the Scottish Government have pointed towards, and we received a letter from the Minister just yesterday with regards to Young Carers Grant and things like that. I just wondered if you'd done any work specifically around these and potential additional successful applicants. In the evidence you'd given to us, you pointed towards 70,000 additional potentially successful applicants with regards to ADP. So I wondered if there was any other work you were doing around potential future benefits and what that would look like as well.
Well, in general, as Claire said, we wait until the government has got a policy that's specified in detail enough, including its timing, for us to move to forecast. So we doesn't mean we don't think about what's in the pipeline, but we don't produce forecasts of it. But Claire, do you want to answer in more detail?
Probably a specific example is I saw the Cabinet Secretary had referred to cold weather payments and the devolution of that starting in the next budget year. So we will be, that's something which is not currently in our headline forecast because they are not devolved and they're not in the Scottish budget. We produce an illustrative forecast of spending on cold weather payments. But if the Scottish Government will be announcing the plans for that at the budget, we will be factoring those into our forecasts and publishing that in December.
So that 70,000 figure, how was that delivered? Or how was that kind of come about then in terms of additional applicants?
Payment. So this is really the things that David's been talking about in terms of we think there will be more applications made to adult disability payment. We think there will be more successful applications, and because the Scottish Government has published the regulations for adult disability payment, they have a firm commitment to introduce that next year. We now feel there's enough information available on the policy direction the government is taking and the implementation plans for us to factor them in.
Thank you very much indeed. Final question from me. Your very helpful briefing points to changes that have had to be made in terms of inflation forecasts. And there's obvious reasons for that, volatility in the economy driven by residual and continuing effects of Brexit, obviously the pandemic as well. 2 points, as we look ahead to the Scottish budget, how difficult is it going to be for you to be able to predict inflation rates, given where we are with regards to the fuel crisis, the energy cost rising, and other costs impacting on households across Scotland? And secondly, where do you expect inflation to be at around the time of the Scottish budget and obviously Christmas?
David.
Well, one point to make at the outset is that in terms of uprating benefits or social security, what matters is the inflation forecast in September of the year before the benefits are uprated. So we forecast that inflation, CPI inflation for September 2021 would be 2.7%. We'll get the exact figure in a very short period of time. So we'll know whether or not that 2.7% figure was accurate or not. But the change between that and the actual figure for September, I think, is likely to be quite small. we are forecasting, or just back in August, we forecast inflation would peak at 4% in the second quarter, in the final quarter of this year. It's conceivable that given the way inflation is actually going, it may carry on into early next year. And that would only have an implication for future years if that affected the level of inflation in September 2022, because that would affect the uprating that would apply in April 23. At the moment, we are forecasting that inflation in September 2022 would be 3.3%. So if inflation rose higher, or if it stayed persistent for longer, our figure for 3.3% that would apply to the 23 budget would be out by a more significant amount. But the degree of error in our forecast for, for September 21 is likely to be quite small, I think.
And looking towards your projected trends towards Christmas?
That, I think, is harder to say. We're forecasting 4%. That was our last forecast. It could be slightly higher than that, but until we actually get figures from Bank of England or OBR, we won't be making another inflation forecast until we publish our December forecast. So we haven't got any official view on this at the moment.
So if I can add two, perhaps slightly, two areas of slight comfort. One, as David has just said, we will be producing a revised inflation forecast in December with a forecast that go alongside the Scottish budget. And the other more general thing to say is there is a lot of uncertainty about inflation forecasting. Inflation has been pretty stable for a long period of time. But the general effects on inflation on the budget are complicated. You know, you'd like to say, well, if everything, inflation shouldn't really matter because everything's inflating, so in real terms, tax revenue, government expenditure, social security expenditure, earnings are all going up. But things don't go up by the same rate of inflation. Some social security benefits are uprated in a particular way, others in a different way. Some tax rates, some tax allowances are inflation adjusted, others are not. So the effect of inflation on the forecast is quite complicated. But quite a lot of the inflation effects wash out, and it's really in the end the real terms effects on the economy that are most important.
But clearly also it'll have an impact on government priorities as well, because if inflation has a squeeze on household budgets as well as the delivery of social security benefits, then it will also affect what government considerations will be coming forward, surely.
Absolutely, and that's a good example of the fact that it's the difference between different rates of increases that really bites. So if prices in the shops are going up by more than wages or social security benefits, then household incomes are taking a painful hit.
Did you want to come in there, Claire?
I suppose just to add from the Scottish budget perspective, obviously when inflation will increase the size of the block grant adjustments in terms of the funding that's received, because the UK government will also be spending more on its social security payments. But where the Scottish government has payments which are new and don't have the sort of corresponding funding, so the Scottish child payment being one example and the additional cost and adult disability payment being another example, the inflation effect there will push up spending, and that will again have to be met elsewhere in the Scottish budget rather than being directly funded by changes in the block grant adjustment.
That is very helpful indeed, and a good conclusion to the session this morning. I really appreciate, on behalf of the committee, your time and the answers that you've given, and, like colleagues, the briefing that you provided in advance. So thank you very much indeed, and we'll no doubt be in touch again very soon to discuss these matters again. So thank you very much to you all. And we now move the committee into private session.